Thank you, Jack. I'd like to start off. There's a comment from or a question from Anthony Martinez, and I'd like to start off with that. He says, can you comment on our national security interests that mandate us to upgrade our infrastructure? You know, if you take a look at manufacturing, it is influenced around the world, and China is flexing its muscles right now, utilizing its massive manufacturing base to influence policy and peoples around this entire world. And that leads me into talking about a meeting we had as the AFL-CIO here in the state of Virginia with Senator Mark Warner. You know, when this pandemic broke out, we had a meeting with him in the summer, and he told us flat out, it was, hey, look, guys, we're going to have to get the PPE we need to protect ourselves from China. And that's a pretty sobering bit of commentary that just teaches you that without manufacturing, you're underprepared for the challenges of the future. And there will be many as technologies continue to increase and get more dangerous as they do. And I'll give you a couple of items that really, really kind of make me wonder about our state right now in manufacturing. Renewables, chip manufacturing. I don't think it takes much effort to look around and recognize that every aspect of our lives now has computer chips in some form of minor AI or automation involved in it. And we're not making those chips. We don't know what's in those chips. We know that if someone was to cut those chips off from us, we would be in some extreme trouble. It's in our roads, our airports, our bridges, our power sources. It's in our military. And this is a very serious bit of national security. And here's the other one is the renewables. As we change our portfolio to these renewables, if we're not our energy portfolio, if we're not manufacturing them, we suffer the same Achilles heel. Someone can cut us off from those sources of maintenance items and other items we need, and we would be in a very serious bit of business if we were not able to quickly manufacture those items. If you go on the internet, it doesn't take very long for you to see that there's a lot of talk about infrastructure and its relationship to manufacturing. And these ideas go back a long, long, long way. Deficits in infrastructure and energy lead to effects on cost, delays, reduction in productivity. These are toxic items to manufacturers. And you know, you absolutely have to have multiple items for manufacturers to even begin to exist in a space, like for roads, bridges, railways, water supplies, utilities, land. There's a big one. Everybody can't continuously stack up in the urban areas. We've got to spread some of that manufacturing out. And to do that, as many different panelists have said, you've got to spread out that network of infrastructure. We are right now, we don't invest enough in our infrastructure as a state. We do what, 2.5% compared to 8% on China. And if you think about that, that leaves no reason for manufacturers to come back. And that leaves the American people, one, without a future. I mean, in a capitalist society, you need jobs. And I think we've noticed this year, as we watched our society turn very chaotic, it started, the catalyst was clearly racial tensions with our police force. But the fact of the matter is, that's a much deeper well of concern from our young people. They don't feel like stakeholders anymore. They don't see a future in the gig economy. So if you go into the manufacturing component as a building trades president, you put all of these people and you train all these people in these different disciplines in the construction field, and you give them real opportunities with Davis-Bacon wages. But those same people, as the manufacturers are built and come back, will retool and become the technicians and specialists within those manufacturers. I found a interesting, and it's from Britain, it's Duffy, Dino, and Ebers, and it's a quote from 1991. It says, the importance of public capital in regional growth stems from its effect on production and location decisions from private industry. So this item is not new. This bank is not novel. It is not also an archaic idea. It's something our competitors use against us every day. And if we can't bring that manufacturing back, we're putting our future as a country and as a people in very serious challenges and in trouble. So with that, I will relinquish my time, and I appreciate the opportunity to speak to everyone, and thank you. Old saying, there are no trade partners, there's trade competitors. And when you look at China, that's what they are. And they're the best part about this, or I should say the most ironic component of this, is that they're utilizing our moves. They have themselves an infrastructure bank. They put 8% into their infrastructure. They know to keep the manufacturing base, which is a huge source of their power. They have to keep the infrastructure there in order to keep those manufacturers there. For us to compete for those manufacturers, we're going to have to take a hard look at our infrastructure. We know that even with the RFC, and we look back at FDR's era, he had to utilize industry, but he had to utilize the bank to affect industry. Left to themselves, industry is a different group of different interests. So he gave it direction and vision through that infrastructure bank. And that, like you said, it militarized our industries and allowed us to win the greatest or the most destructive war in human history. And if I have the opportunity here, I'd like to answer Mr. Goodman's question, which is a very interesting question. He says, your panelist overwhelmingly represents organized labor. And that's just this panel, Mr. Goodman. There's been a mix throughout the different panels as they've gone through the webinars. And then he mentions Taft-Hartley. And then there, I guess the dot connecting is, I doubt that they will have much more effect on rebuilding the country's infrastructure. That's why we're in the coalition, because no one group can do this alone. And thus we joined this coalition, at least under my council and my AF, my federation here in the state of Virginia. And if you want to take it in the other direction, we have over 1,600 high-tech facilities training people right now in the building trades. We spend $1 billion a year. We utilize the apprenticeship model, which is the best model. And I believe that makes us only second to the United States military. We are scalable for at least the work challenge, and we're here to put a lot of weight, as much weight as we have, into getting this infrastructure into reality. Thank you.